Hi, John Reed, Aerodinosaur. Thanks for joining me today. After more than 30 years, what follows is a re-release of my original DC-7C video entitled DC-7C, the 7C Solution, which was first released in VHS cassette form in September 1992. This video utilized the raw footage I took while flying a jump seat on Transair Link's DC-7CF freighter, November 869 Tango Alpha, in March 1992, with my assistant, Doug Teal, in the other jump seat. This was the very last DC-7C and the last of any DC-7 model to see Part 121 airline service. That said, over the last 30 years, I've had viewers comment that I was incorrect about that last statement and tell me they still have seen less than a handful of DC-7s on the active registry up until very recently. However, I would suggest that they carefully revisit the specifics of what I had said, especially as it relates to the Part 121 operating certificate. Those DC-7s seen by these viewers on the active registry were not operating in regular airline service under Part 121, but were so-called straight DC-7s or DC-7Bs, operating as firebomber and special applications aircraft, most recently operated by Ericsson Aerotanker in Oregon. Those DC-7s operated irregularly under the much less stringent Part 91 rules and not under the much stricter Part 121 charter or common carrier airline service. That said, these last few special use non-airline DC-7s have finally been retired recently, approximately 25 years after our subject DC-7C was finally retired as the last DC-7 in airline service. The DC-7 has finally been silenced forever. Also, I'd like to mention that to date, no other comprehensive, modern-day operational footage of any DC-7C, inside and out with authentic audio, has surfaced, as passenger carrier, freighter, or otherwise. Yes, around 2010, there was a shiny DC-7B restoration flying around in Eastern Airlines colors, resulting in several very good, comprehensive video programs appearing on YouTube in high definition. However, this was a flying museum for paid enthusiasts going to air shows and special events, not a dirty old, worn-out, saddle-tanked DC-7C conducting normal daily Part 121 airline service that no longer existed in 2010. Also, one blown engine put this fabulous museum piece out of service for good. So, just to set the record straight, it appears we caught the very last authentic DC-7 airline operation way back in 1992. DC-7C, the 7C solution, was one of less than a handful of so-called modern propliner videos available at the time. The result of my discovering an arbitrage opportunity, or hole in the market, as they say. Sales were brisk at a ridiculous $34.95 per copy, meaning it was a highly lucrative and profitable video back then. It could actually put food on the table. This kind of insane arbitrage is no longer possible in this age of social media, at least as far as propliners go. You'll certainly notice this video was anything but a Pixar-quality special effects media production, only an effort by one guy in his basement trying to teach himself video production along the way using 1992 Super VHS video technology. High definition? Nope. Despite these minor shortfalls, our video cassettes were nonetheless watchable and sold through mail order worldwide using magazine display ads and through aviation media retailer World Transport Press out of Miami, Florida. There was no such thing as the internet, much less YouTube, Instagram, Facebook, or Amazon back then. Nine Tango Alpha's life started in the late 1950s in regular international passenger service with KLM, Royal Dutch Airlines, under the registration PHDSI, or Delta Sigma India. In 1962, it was converted by KLM into a freighter where speed was not as important as jetliners were rapidly replacing piston airliners in worldwide passenger service. KLM flew Delta Sigma India in dedicated freight service until February 1969, when it went to Air Tourists out of Ireland and re-registered EIATV, or Alpha Tango Victor. Only 3 months later, in May 1969, it was acquired by legendary South African air mercenary Jack Malik and flown to his maintenance base in Salisbury, Rhodesia, and he re-registered the 7C as TRLNZ, or Lima November Zulu, with his freight airline Afriter. At the time, Nigeria was in the midst of a bloody civil war with Biafra, which was attempting to secede from Nigeria. Malik repositioned this DC-7C at his staging base in Libreville, Gabon, where it was put into heavy use on the extensive Biafran mercenary airlift. It made daily flights into Sao Tome Island in the Atlantic, just off the west coast of Nigeria and Biafra. And then from there, it made nightly flights, sneaking through the contested Biafran airspace and into the dangerous Uli airstrip combat zone to unload, before returning to Libreville early in the morning, only to do it all again the next day and the next. These flights were part of the largest civilian airlift ever, involving air mercenaries, the Red Cross, and church-sponsored relief organizations worldwide, bringing in arms for the Biafran defenders, as well as foodstuffs and medical supplies for the starved-out civilians. It was not a typical military airlift, such as the well-known Berlin airlift of 1948 and 1949. Jack Malik's Lima November Zulu was said to provide extremely reliable service in this airlift compared to other propliners in this role. Because of the widespread misery and famine in Biafra, it's also likely that some of Malik's loads into Uli included humanitarian cargo, including stockfish and other basic food staples, as well as medical supplies. Because of its specific timing in aeronautical history, the Biafran airlift was unique in that it was conducted by the largest assembly of obsolete, second-hand, late-model propliner freighters ever to be seen before or after, including DC-4s, DC-6s, DC-7s, and 7CFs, Lockheed Constellations and Super Constellations, and Boeing C-97 Stratofreighters. Many of these propliners were destroyed by anti-aircraft fire from the ground and in the air, with crews killed or badly injured, and a large percentage of the planes were abandoned and cannibalized during the operation. In the frenzied heat of the airlift, these cheap and otherwise run-out planes were considered expendable throwaways. A massive assembly of these old piston birds and wholesale abandonments can never happen again. These planes are all but extinct. As it turned out, despite lives saved, it was mostly for naught. By early 1970, Biafra lost the war and the airlift was disbanded. In the subject video, the string of subsequent African operators of Lima November Zulu in Africa that I mention is not entirely accurate. Actually, after the airlift, Malik continued his Afriter DC-7C legal and not-so-legal freight operations out of Salisbury, along with parent company Air Transafrica, and then lent Lima November Zulu to the Rhodesian Air Force during the 1977 through 1980 escalation of the Rhodesian Bush War, near the conclusion of which the country was renamed Zimbabwe. During that war, Lima November Zulu was often used as a paratrooper platform for the Rhodesian military. After the war, Lima November Zulu was returned to Afriter and flew with them in both legal operations and, as necessary, under the radar, illegal operations until 1982, when Malik died by inadvertently slamming his restored Rolls-Royce Griffin-powered Mark 22 Spitfire into a fierce tropical thunderstorm in Zimbabwe. Still, in very good condition, with relatively low time in 1982, our DC-7C was acquired by La Mancha Air out of Miami, Florida that year, and flown from Zimbabwe across the Atlantic via Brazil to its new home in Miami, obtaining a new U.S. registration. Up until 1985, a couple of other U.S. operators flew it for a short time before it was acquired by TransAirLink that year, also out of Miami, and re-registered November 869 Tango Alpha. So here we are. The second half of this video features what was once the legendary Jack Malik's DC-7C mercenary plane, now as 9 Tango Alpha in all its glory, working hard with TransAirLink in the Caribbean in March 1992. At the conclusion of the story, we'll summarize the mysterious fate of 9 Tango Alpha, ironically back in Africa, before the turn of the millennium. Also, the kid you will see and hear during this narration is yours truly, more than half a life ago. And now, for a little bit of self-criticism. In a few places, I may project a tinge of boyish know-it-all arrogance, because at the time I couldn't understand why more aviation enthusiasts didn't possess the same passion that I did about prop liners. As I grew older and matured a little more, actually not much more, I realized that the world doesn't revolve around prop liners or any other obscure special interest for that matter.
Hi, I'm John Reed. I've spent some years studying less publicized facets of aviation history. Though record-breaking flights and air combat glory are always exciting, I tend to focus more on the technological underpinnings. Today's topic centers on international flight. For most of us, this conjures images of 747s or supersonic Concordes. To be blunt, it was the advent of jet power over 3 decades ago that ignited today's globalized world. Not telecommunications or the computer. Think about it. But today, we're not going to talk about commercial jets. Instead, we'll experience an airliner that arrived on the scene before them. I'm not hinting toward our beloved old DC-3, but instead a plane that arrived 2 decades later. Though it still used the same piston and prop technology as the 3, it was far more advanced in size, complexity, and power, representing a big milestone for international flight. The bitter irony is that it received little credit for its role. Strangely, when it comes to aviation history, journalistic preference is to glamorize the old DC-3 or World War II Warbirds or almost any fast jet. But we hear next to nothing about the 15-year transition period encompassing the 50s, where heavy piston air power was at its mightiest domination, both militarily and commercially. An era where the same struggles, adventures, and milestones happened just as in more publicized eras. Let's have a look. Non-stop overseas travel, up to one quarter of the way around the globe in half a day. Now a routine exercise taken for granted by millions. But once upon a time, transatlantic flight was an adventure, a real novelty. Even well into the post-World War II era, only a privileged few experienced it. It was the era of the propeller flagship Titans. All first-class seating, gourmet dining, real silverware and sleeper berths were the rule with international carriers such as Pan Am, TWA, and British Overseas. In the 50s, a North Atlantic trip would take 12 hours or more, over twice as long as it takes today, almost necessitating these luxuries. A typical westbound flight required at least one refueling stop because of fierce prevailing headwinds. Even this advanced, long-range DC-7B had to regularly stop and refuel at Gander, Newfoundland.
Big reciprocating internal combustion power plants, locomotive-like outputs in the thousands of horsepower, dwarfing even the mightiest World War II warbird. A primal reverberation far from the sleepy whisper of today's turbofan. Reliability of these dinosaur engines was acceptable but less than perfect by today's standards. Early on, a three-engine arrival of four-engine flagship was not considered that unusual by passenger or crew. Back then, Douglas and Lockheed dominated. The Douglas DC-4 and Lockheed L-49 Constellation were the wartime designs from which the post-war derivatives evolved. From here sprang the DC-6, the L-749, and DC-6B, and by late 1953, the L-1049C Super Constellation and the DC-7. These represent a maximum gross weight increase from 73,000 to 133,000 pounds, improving range from 1,300 to 4,000 miles for a typical 40 to 80 passenger payload. But the solution for reliable nonstop transatlantic service remained elusive. Not even the Lockheed L-1049G Super Constellation of 1955, with an extra 1,200 gallons of tip tank fuel, was able to make this particular trip under all westbound conditions. Design engineers kept scratching their heads in dismay. An airplane is truly no better than the power plant that pulls it, and until jet power could become practical, the complex World War II-era air-cooled radial engine had to meet the post-war commercial growth. These cumbersome old reciprocators had to be modified, tweaked, even overdeveloped to churn out very high outputs, to almost 1 horsepower per pound of engine weight. By comparison, some of today's modern turbofans pull over 6 equivalent horsepower per pound with ease. But only 1 horsepower per pound is much to ask from a behemoth with hundreds of reciprocating and revolving parts. Interestingly, the Constellation series evolved using one basic radial, the 18-cylinder Curtiss Wright R3350, which showed a 55% improvement in takeoff output in only one decade from 2,200 horsepower in 1943 to 3,400 horses by 1953. Incidentally, R means radial, and 3350 represents approximate cubic inch displacement. On the other hand, Douglas piston liners grew with 3 different radial sizes. The DC-4 used the 1,450 horse Pratt & Whitney R2000 Twin Wasp D, and the DC-6, the 2,500 horse Pratt & Whitney R2800 Double Wasp. Though it took a while for these engines to grow into such outputs, neither of the Pratt & Whitney radials evolved like the Wright R3350. And despite its superb reliability, the R2800 lacked the muscle to be an effective transatlantic engine under increasing passenger load factors seen during the 50s. Not until the appearance of the DC-7 did Douglas use the R3350, then in its most developed turbo compound form. The first R3350, called Duplex Cyclone, arrived in early World War II for the Boeing B-29 Superfortress at a 2,200 horsepower takeoff rating. This superbomber would play a decisive role in ending the war as the platform for incendiary attacks on Japan, coupled with its nuclear drops on Hiroshima and Nagasaki. Unfortunately, this engine-airframe combination was a deadly fire trap. Panicked wartime needs rushed the B-29 into combat prematurely. Too much magnesium in the engine makeup gave it the flammability of a Christmas tree. The early engine also had serious design flaws centering on cooling. Considering that its cylinders retained heat like thermos jugs, they served as the perfect match to ignite the Christmas tree. Once a magnesium engine fire started, the wing was said to burn off in 2 minutes. It was clearly just as dangerous to be a B-29 crewman as it was to be the enemy on the ground. Just after the war, and thousands of power plant modifications later, the deplorable Duplex Cyclone actually became safe enough to fly passengers in the L-49 Constellation. Over the next few years, outputs per cubic inch grew. Easy in theory, hard in practice. Theory said to beef up the engine structure, use a higher compression ratio and less volatile high-octane fuel, then crank up the manifold boost from the supercharger. But in practice, this led to cylinder overheating and power loss at best, or detonation and even fiery self-destruction at worst. More horsepower means disproportionately higher engine heat. To improve piston liner performance along any measure, engine cooling would be the primary bottleneck. If the engine couldn't run at the right temperature, the airframe didn't do much good, as experience with the B-29 proved. By 1950, takeoff power from this commercial R-3350, happily renamed Cyclone 18, reached 2,800 horsepower. This extra output was achieved largely by a redesigned cylinder head with better cooling. It evolved from this crude fin pattern seen on this duplex Cyclone cylinder cutaway to this refined pattern found on the more powerful Cyclone 18. Other improvements came into play for better temperature control, including baffle plate design, cowling design, and larger cowl flaps to handle increased cooling air flows. Other changes included more massive engine oil coolers, and in some cases water alcohol injection for internal cylinder head cooling at brief maximum power settings. In transoceanic service, advertised speed was important, but range was more important. Why? Because the natural limitations of piston and prop made cruise speeds over 300 miles per hour somewhat costly. The true value of more horsepower was the ability to take off with more fuel in order to fly farther. That is, the ability to take off and endure at higher gross weights without a payload penalty. But even as late as 1956, not a single piston liner could boast westbound transatlantic reliability at normal payloads. Not even the huge Boeing 377 Stratocruiser, first appearing in 1949. This thing was powered by the most complicated nightmare of all, the 28-cylinder Pratt & Whitney R4360 Wasp Major, pulling 3,500 horses each on takeoff. Maybe a lot of juice, but the engine was heavy, complicated, unreliable, and ran hot, and the airframe itself had the weight and aerodynamic qualities of a brickyard.
But as early as World War II, Curtiss Wright and the U.S. Navy were developing a very long-range engine, one that would be as powerful as the Wasp Major, but lighter and more fuel-efficient, one that could handle the Navy's long overwater patrols while carrying a heavy ordnance, usually consisting of tons of vacuum tube electronics, sonobuoys, rockets, and depth charges.
The result? The R-3350 turbo compound. Knowing that 40% of a piston engine's energy is wasted in its own exhaust, Wright recaptured some of it by adding three small exhaust-driven turbines to the standard Cyclone 18. These power recovery turbines, or PRTs, were fluid coupled directly to the crankshaft. Mounted 120 degrees apart, just behind the cylinder rows, each PRT added 150 horsepower at maximum output. And presto, a fully developed 2,800-horse engine suddenly pulls 3,250 horses. Output is increased over 15% with no increase in fuel consumption. And at cruise altitudes, exhaust gas escapes faster, working the PRTs harder, actually decreasing fuel consumption. An aeronautical designer's dream. What did this give the Navy? A welcome trade-off between 20% greater payload or range for the same fuel capacity. Just what their Lockheed P-2 Neptune anti-submarine aircraft needed in the Cold War era. In 1950, the P-2 became the first aircraft to utilize the turbo compound. Naturally, the airlines were quick to catch on. By late 1953, the turbo compound was introduced in airline service by KLM Royal Dutch Airlines with its new L-1049C Super Constellations, shortly followed by American with its new DC-7s on transcontinental routes. The big and complicated turbo compound would become the standard transoceanic power plant of the 50s, perhaps overdeveloped and temperamental, but eventually quite reliable if flown by the book. The airlines finally had the right long-range engine, but the airframes had to catch up with the turbo compound's potential. As a temporary measure, Pan Am put the turbo compounded DC-7B into transatlantic service while Douglas went to work on further increasing the 7's fuel capacity. The result? The DC-7C, appropriately named Seven Seas. Pan Am put it into service in June 56, followed by other majors such as Braniff, Northwest, SAS, KLM, Sabena, Swiss Air, and British Overseas. With each turbo compound now cleared for 3,400 horses, the Seven Seas was an overnight success with its nominal 5,000-mile range. Finally, transatlantic, any direction, nonstop, for all of us. The first true ocean spanner. London to New York or Paris to Washington. No Gander, Newfoundland, no Keflavik, Iceland. A sigh of relief almost 30 long years after a single man named Charles A. Lindbergh made his epic nonstop flight. How did Douglas do it? The original DC-7 came about because of a request from American Airlines. Their transcontinental DC-6 routes were seriously threatened by TWA's turbo-compounded Super Connies. Though the 7 was lighter, faster, simpler, and cheaper than the Super Connie, it still had vastly inferior range. So Douglas introduced the 7B in 1955 with greater fuel capacity. Still, the 7B's improved 4,200-mile range was inadequate for most westbound North Atlantic flights. Accordingly, the 7Cs represented a significant design improvement with 10 extra feet of zero dihedral span at the wing route. This housed additional fuel and pushed the power plants further from the passenger cabin for a quieter flight. The tail fin shape was refined and its area increased, and the fuselage was lengthened over 3 feet. The result was an airplane with a maximum gross weight of 143,000 pounds and a range that allowed SAS to introduce over-the-pole flights from Europe to the Far East. The trade-off? A slower cruise speed than the DC-7B. The DC-6 and 7 production lines were shut down during 1958. Douglas built 705 6s, 216 7s and 7Bs, and 121 7Cs, making them the most successful piston liner manufacturer. Straightforward design and superior operating economics, particularly with the 6, were the primary reasons. Many have trouble differentiating between the DC-6 and 7. It's best to check the power plants. All 6s utilized 3-blade props, 8 moderate-sized cowl flaps, 4 on each side, and a modest induction air scoop atop the assembly. All 7s used 4-blade props, 4 massive cowl flaps, 2 on each side, and much larger air scoop masses. Careful observers will also notice differences in exhaust dump arrangements necessitated by the spacing of the PRTs on the 7.
The 7Cs was clearly one of the milestones in aviation history, though it fell victim to a brutal irony. What happened? Jetliners began taking over 7C routes by late 1958, only 2 years after its introduction. The Boeing 707 and Douglas DC-8 meant twice the payload, almost twice as fast and nearly as far. From then on, airliners were called jets and passengers were whisked, not flown.
With incredibly low airframe times, many 7Cs were then converted to freighters and or sold, quietly continuing their service in obscurity, actually living out most of their useful lives that way. By the late 1980s, the remaining spare parts pool could only support a handful of operable 7Cs, the vast majority of planes having since seen the scrapper's torch.
Now we're going to shift gears a little, so I'd like to introduce my associate, Doug Teal, who will steer us into the next part of the program. Doug?
Thanks, John. Now comes the fun part. Believe it or not, there is still one DC-7 that's certificated to U.S. airline standards under FAR Part 121. It's a 7Cs owned and operated by Trans Airlink Corporation out of Miami International. The plane is meticulously maintained to those standards with full factory support to this day, and even the cabin pressurization system is still used. As a freighter, it's designated a DC-7CF, delivering goods throughout the Caribbean. John and I went down to have a look.
At a reduced maximum gross weight of 129,000 pounds, November 869 Tango Alpha still carries 33% more cargo than the three DC-6 sister ships, also with Transair Link. Its turbo compounds have been derated to 2,800 horses each, not because of their age, but due to the discontinuance of high-octane 115-145 fuel some time ago. Only 100 octane is available now, which cannot stand the heat of 3,400 horses. Accordingly, the reduced power translates into reduced gross weight. Also, the lack of original fuel requires the deactivation of the high blower supercharger settings, reducing service ceiling from 21,000 feet to about 15,000 feet. 9 Tango Alpha is a 7Cs that still proudly flies over two of them, and you're about to go along, but you'll have to roll up your sleeves, work hard, and endure odd hours. It's been 3 decades since this 7Cs pampered its last fare-paying passenger. At 1 a.m. tomorrow morning, our Flight 108 will depart for a 4.5-hour run to the island of St. Martin, which is 1,000 nautical miles southeast of Miami. After freight transfer, we'll hop over to St. Croix, then St. Thomas, U.S. Virgin Islands, then to San Juan, and then Barrancan, Puerto Rico for an overnight. The following morning, our Flight 109 hauls a return load back to Miami. We'll cover 2,500 nautical miles on this 30-hour trip, which is scheduled twice weekly. 12 hours prior to departure, maintenance engineers descend on the airplane. By virtue of its PRTs, the turbo compound was the most complicated of all radial engines. Accordingly, its maintenance is cumbersome and truly a lost art now practiced by a very few. Most mechanics today are more comfortable with the turbine, which has only a handful of moving parts, resulting in easier servicing and much less daily maintenance. But with the radials, run-ups, testing, and tweaking are never-ending. Late in the afternoon, the cargo shipments pile up in front of TransAirLink's headquarters. Loading and fueling begin about 9 hours before departure. Wing and over-nacelle saddle tanks are filled with 3,200 gallons of 100 low-lead fuel. Total fuel capacity is 7,800 gallons. All-up gross weight after fueling and loading will be nearly 124,000 pounds. The saddle tanks were an effort to increase the range of the DC-7. A few 7Bs and all 7Cs featured the added tankage in bulky nacelle extensions over the wing. This freighter has a payload capacity of 35,000 pounds and will be nearly full with 33,000 pounds on her first leg. Strict weight and balance requirements necessitate careful staging of all cargo on the ramp before loading. The cargo manifest shows optical goods, shirts, sail parts, electronics, and seafood bound for St. Martin, seafood, plants, and office supplies for St. Croix, and foodstuffs, computer equipment, outboard motor parts, bedspreads, footwear, pharmaceuticals, and a water pump going to St. Thomas. Some loading requires a little ingenuity. This 7Cs entered passenger service with KLM Royal Dutch Airlines in mid-57. The airline converted it to a freighter in 62 and then sold it to secondary operators as KLM went all jet. By the late 60s, the aircraft was operating in Africa. After a brief period of inactivity, it was resurrected in the mid-70s to fly with Air Gabon Cargo, Air Trans Africa, the Rhodesia Zimbabwe Air Force, and then Afriter by the early 80s. In 82, it was purchased by La Mancha Air of Miami and ferried across the South Atlantic via Brazil. It flew with several Caribbean operators before being purchased by TransAirLink in 1985. It has since proven to be TransAirLink's most valuable asset, largely because of their unique ability to track down difficult parts and efficiently maintain and operate the airplane. At midnight, our crew arrives to finalize paperwork and perform pre-flight checks. We're properly loaded and fueled. Our captain is Jacques Magnan. He goes through his preliminary checklist. Our IFR flight plan calls for us to track low-frequency route Amber 555, cruising at 11,000 feet. We'll be monitored by Houston radio. Weather is not a factor, but there's considerable low cloud cover over the destination islands, which will call for a bit of instrument flying. Our flight engineer, George Alvarez, has completed his walk-around checks and buttons us in.
24,000 on takeoff.
Yeah.
And standing by to get the ATIS.
Our first officer is Kai Adeduji. The international diversity of our crew is appropriate for the role this aircraft played in commercial air history. Jacques is a Swiss national, Kai is of a missionary family and was born and raised in Africa, and George is of Cuban descent. Each is a seasoned professional with thousands of hours in heavy equipment.
Okay, before starting.
Check, burner standing by, flight instrument radios.
Okay, set on the left.
Coming up on the right. X-ray is current.
Okay, I got the logbook, three gear pins, heater compartment, paperwork.
Okay.
Do you have paperwork on board?
Yeah, it's right there.
3200 on the fuel, 120 on the oil, box is full, ADI is full. Start check is complete.
Okay. Turning.
Okay.
We're cleared to taxi to runway 9 right, but first a stop at the run-up area where George advances each engine to 1700 RPM for prop check and then to field barometric for magneto check. He'll use the electronic engine analyzer scope behind him to monitor each of 72 cylinders, 144 spark plugs, 4 dual magnetos, and 8 distributors. Takeoff flap setting is 20 degrees. This goes on for the next 20 minutes. It seems like a miracle that everything checks out, but it does more often than not. Takeoff settings, 2900 RPM and 53 inches manifold pressure. V1 is 110 knots, V2 120. After liftoff, raise gear and reduce power to maximum except takeoff, or MITO, at 43.5 inches and 2800 RPM. Raise flaps and reduce to climb power at 180 PSI, brake mean effective pressure, termed BMEP, and 2500 RPM. BMEP is combustion pressure, the most precise measure of piston output. We leave the Florida coastline to become a lonely speck over the uninviting and dark ocean void. Climb rate averages 500 feet per minute on this cool evening, even with our near full load. Climb speed, 175 knots. It took almost 30 minutes to reach 11,000 feet, at which time power was reduced to 160 BMEP and 2200 RPM. Cruise speed, about 195 knots. Three hours later, sunrise. Later, we begin our instrument descent by throttling back to 120 BMEP and 2100 RPM.
Check. 20 here, coming down.
Runway 9 in sight, 2100 RPM, 120 BMEP, gear down, flap settings as needed, 130 knots. On short final, flaps 50 degrees. Shock has the throttles with 110 knots indicated over the threshold. Winds east at 15. Seven thirty-five AM. Fuel burn 2200 gallons, 1000 gallons remaining.
Pressure's up, boys.
Unloading went smoothly, and we're ahead of schedule for the U.S. Virgin Islands. We clear the infamous St. Martin Hill at the departure end and are on our way to St. Croix, a 30-minute flight. We continue ahead of schedule at St. Croix, and unloading occurs quickly. We take on no new cargo, but a few hundred gallons of fuel are added to legalize the next two legs to San Juan, where full refueling will take place for the return trip. At 11 a.m., we're ready to go to St. Thomas. We'll depart runway 9 for a left turnout and a 25-minute flight. Unlike its smaller Pratt & Whitney contemporaries, the huge turbo compound had to be babied and run strictly by the numbers for reliable operation. As the old Navy saying went, hell hath no fury like an R-3350 scorned. Keeping that in mind, notice how slowly and deliberately George reduces to cruise power. All remaining cargo is unloaded here at St. Thomas. We'll be leaving for San Juan on another 25-minute jaunt, almost 2 hours ahead of schedule. The other infamous hill. Luckily, we're empty. This is San Juan. If it were 35 years earlier, it could just as well be Hong Kong, Rio, Bombay, or Cairo, and we passengers would have a few drinks under our belt. Here we go through customs and refuel. At first, it looks like we'll leave early for Barrancan and rest a few extra hours. We're wrong. Our crew suddenly notices that the slave engines, numbers 1, 2, and 4, are not obeying the number 3 master engines, prop synchronization commands, in automatic mode. It works manually, but manual is only a backup option. Captain Jacques feels we'll be stuck here a day or two and perhaps even lose our return load, and that TAL mechanics may have to be flown in from Miami to fix the problem. Thankfully, Jacques' concerns do not materialize. After conferring with Miami, George diagnoses and totally remedies the problem in 3 hours. A short circuit in the number 3 prop governor blew a fuse in the prop synchronization box, a crude electronic brain found in the lower fuselage. Spare prop governors and fuses are always carried below deck for such emergencies, so George changes out the offending governor as well as the sync box fuse. It's dark when number 3 is run up, but all circuits check out. Our return load is saved, and Jacques decides to go to Barrancan and get it. But en route, a totally unrelated problem surfaces. Though we're able to get gear down and locked and lower flaps to the proper approach settings, hydraulic pressure powering these items falls to zero. Cross-checking verifies that the pressure gauge is not at fault. Jacques indicates that as a precaution, prop reversal will be used after touchdown because wheel brake effectiveness may be degraded. Thankfully, there's enough residual pressure for the wheel brakes to function, but pressure is indeed weak. We've had a very long day and we'll have to deal with this new problem in the morning. In the meantime, we'll be loaded overnight with 15,000 pounds of pharmaceuticals and electronics equipment. The next morning, First Officer Kai Adeduji powers up the hydraulic system by running the number 2 power plant. George is able to isolate a worn O-ring in the hydraulic manifold in the lower deck. It turns out that our spare O-ring kit has everything except the size and type we need. So, our crew checks with every air freight operation at the busy Barenkin Ramey airfield with zero luck. But our problem is suddenly advantageous to both TransAirLink and its customer. An extra 5,000 pounds of cargo arrives during our mechanical delay. In the meantime, an Aero Air Stretch DC-8 jet freighter arrives. Its crew is kind enough to let Jacques and George check the DC-8's spare O-ring kit. We're in luck.
What'd you find?
Think it might work out.
Great.
George installs the O-ring, adds hydraulic fluid, and one more run-up confirms that hydraulic pressure is restored. The crew's ingenuity at solving unexpected problems is verified for a second consecutive time. Though a certain amount of field wizardry is expected, Jacques swears he's never seen anything like this trip. By 10 a.m., we're ready to go to Miami, so George checks the fuel tank readings with a dipstick. Kai will fly pilot in command on this 4-hour final leg.
That number 3. Turning 4, 8, 12.
Bravo 1, clear?
What is clear?
Turning 1.
Turning.
After that long run-up, we're all set. Jacques has a final commentary on how things have been going this trip. We're up to speed at our 12,000-foot cruise altitude, so George hauls back on the BMEP first, and then engine RPM to cruise power. Three hours later, the Florida coastline. There you have it. So, the next time one of your friends boasts about being pampered in one of these, or even one of these, why not mention your experience with the Heavy Piston Titans and the DC-7C? Unsung titans that truly laid the solid foundation for the jet age we're all familiar with.